Nigeria and Afghanistan, possibly the two most corrupt countries.
But this particular president is actually not corrupt.
I'm not going to demand any apology from anybody. What I'm demanding is the return of assets.
From this day forward, it's going to be only America first. America first.
The intellectual capacity of the president is protozoan.
Can you really lay out the red carpet for Pete, for someone who has talked about grabbing women by the
I think about a man who thinks it's okay to go and grab
Tout le monde nous disait que c'était impossible.
Everyone said it was impossible.
Mais ils ne connaissaient pas la France.
They didn't know France.
When the Supreme Court of Kenya annulled the presidential election held in August, it was to many a confusion of excitement as well as anxiety. While it was unprecedented in Africa, where the judiciary is often perceived as an appendage of the executive, the Kenya election had gulped a whopping $500 million, making it the most expensive election in the world, coming only after the United States on a cost-per-voter basis. Now, the future of the biggest economy in East Africa is a bit uncertain, as a rerun election is most likely going to impact negatively on the country's economy. On Global Arena this week, we're taking a look at the Kenya presidential election and the lessons for democracy in Africa. I am Nifemi Oguntoye. Thanks for joining us. Welcome back. Now, Kenya's Supreme Court has declared Uhuru Kenyatta's victory in the presidential election held in August invalid and ordered a new vote to be held within 60 days. The six-judge bench ruled 4-2 in favor of a petition filed by Odinga, who claimed the electronic voting results were hacked and manipulated in favor of the incumbent.
Now, having heard from both sides, I want to read the declaration is hereby issued that the third respondent was not validly elected, declared as the president-elect, and that the declaration is invalid, null, and void. Third, an order is hereby issued directing the first respondent to organize and conduct a fresh presidential election in strict conformity with the Constitution and the applicable election laws within 60 days of the determination under Article 143 of the Constitution.
The decision to nullify the result sets up a new race for the presidency between incumbent President Uhuru Kenyatta and the veteran opposition leader Raila Odinga. While Odinga celebrates the court's decision, calling it an exceptional example for all Africa, President Kenyatta says it's a situation where six people had gone against the will of the people.
I personally disagree with the ruling that has been made today. But I respect it as much as I disagree with it. I respect it. I disagree with it because, as I have said, millions of Kenyans queued, made their choice, and six people have decided that they will go against the will of the people.
The decision is precedent setting. It will reverberate across Kenya, the African continent, and the rest of the world through generations to come. Never again will impunity reign in Kenya. It is now clear that no one in Kenya is above the law. A new Kenya has been born by this ruling. And Kenya is once again leading Africa, as it so often does, with its vibrant democracy, except at election time.
Meanwhile, former President Olusegun Obasanjo and five of his counterparts in Africa have called for peace and fairness in the presidential rerun election coming up next month in Kenya. The other leaders are Ghana's John Kufuor, Gotemba Emongei of Botswana, Tanzania's Benjamin William Mkapa, Tunisia's Mohamed Monsef Mazoki, and Kgalema Petrus Muntale of South Africa. In a joint statement by the six former presidents entitled Kenya, A Plea for Peace, they described the August 8, 2017 election and its subsequent annulment on September the 4th as a watershed in the history of the East African country. They noted that events ordinarily seem innocuous, but anyone conversant with the realities on the ground in Kenya would be concerned, hence the need to call for peace in the build-up to the repetition of the presidential elections in less than 60 days, as well as immediately after. To shed more light on the development in Kenya, I spoke with a political scientist and lawyer, Dr. Babafemi Badijo, who prior to his role as head of political affairs at the UN mission in Liberia, served as deputy special representative of the UN Secretary General for Somalia. Badijo was resident in Kenya for over a decade, working on Somalia from Nairobi. He played primary role in the design, negotiation and implementation of the Djibouti initiative that set up national governance structures for Somalia after a decade of civil strife. He also organized and participated in peace accord negotiations among Somali leaders that resulted in the Nairobi Declaration of March 1994. He is the author of the book Raila Odinga, An Enigma in Kenya Politics, a book that tells the story of politics in Kenya and Raila's role in them. It's been described by critics as a marvelous abridged version of Kenya political history over the last 60 years and an excellent introduction for the uninitiated to the complex landscape of Kenyan politics. Dr. Femi Badijo, thank you so much for joining us at Global Arena.
No, you're very welcome.
Let's begin from 1964, when the Republic of Kenya was formed. Jomo Kenyatta and Oginga Odinga were the first president and vice president, respectively. 44 years after, the children, Uhuru Kenyatta, as well as Raila Odinga, became prime minister and deputy prime minister in a power-sharing arrangement after the 2007 election crisis. Fast forward to 2017. In a couple of weeks now, in October, the same names, Kenyatta and Odinga, are going to be on the polling booth for the rerun presidential election. In your opinion, what makes this name still relevant in the Kenyan politics?
That stuff, one has to look at the decolonization struggle in Kenya in order to understand the different roles that those two founding fathers that you mentioned played. And immediately after independence, they are falling out over differences of opinion, differences of position on how the country should be run along the ideological issues of those days, simmered down into ethnicity. And the division between the Luos and the Kikuyus could be traced back to the differences between these two personalities, because these two personalities collaborated. Now, the British even wanted to offer Oginga Odinga the leadership of the country while they were keeping Kenyatta away in jail. But Oginga Odinga insisted that my leader has to be here. You know, but of course, the rest is history.
But then there are some who would even say that years after, that this continued struggle to hold power between Kenyatta and Odinga is a continuation of the feud between their forefathers. How relevant is that now?
Well, I wouldn't put it exactly that way, because there has been quite a lot of collaboration towards changing the governance arrangement in Kenya. Raila and his father
were in the strong push against President Moi's one-party rule.
Okay.
And that struggle together was not an ethnic struggle. Mm. It was the struggle that the Kenyans called the Second Liberation of Kenya.
Okay.
And it brought several people, some even from the Kikuyu side of the house, to join hands because Kibaki himself, Matiba, all these people were Kikuyus who were on the forefront with Oginga Odinga and Raila Odinga inheriting that mantle. And time in jail in order to ensure that second liberation that ended up taking place with President Moi agreeing that, okay, we'll do multi-party system.
Jomo Kenyatta died in office in 1978 after spending 14 years. He was succeeded by his vice president, Daniel Arap Moi, who spent 24 years in office. Moi, on the other hand, was succeeded by Kibaki, who had served as vice president under Moi for 10 years. Now, the main political figures in Kenya, as we speak now, haven't changed much since 1960. Some would say it's the African thing to want to hold them to power. What do you think is responsible for that?
Well, again, you have immediately mentioned the question of the sit-tight syndrome in African politics. A number of structural efforts are being made to change some of that. Some of the struggles of Raila Odinga that I spoke about earlier on towards multipartism, that means you could have a choice at least, towards a new constitution for Kenya, which equally meant that you have a limited term of office. Of course, don't forget the fact that African leaders very easily changed that later. You know, quite a number of them have been doing that. But so far, some of those structural issues have started to kick in. Moi himself would have continued if he wasn't constrained that he had to go. And he's going, bringing in Kibaki.
Let's talk about the main figures in this rerun election. Raila Odinga, you wrote a whole book on him, an enigma of the Kenya politics. His father led the opposition for close to 28 years, never become president. At 72 years, the August election was perhaps Raila's fourth attempt at running for presidency, and he even vowed to serve for only a term if he won. Would you say this is Raila's last chance? And what's your opinion about his chances of winning this rerun?
I don't want to respond as somebody who was involved a little in that election because I did spend some time in Kenya in July of this year. But as a scholar, Raila was not having a chance of running again because the constitution had fixed that wasn't going to be. So he has to hand over to one of the people that they formed a coalition together.
Okay.
Now, the problem of the media is being highlighted in the social media. Because for some reason, the regular media started talking about Uhuru had won. Well, even today, I was listening to Al Jazeera and was surprised that Al Jazeera was saying President Uhuru Kenyatta spoke to Parliament, he won the last election. How can you say he won when Supreme Court of the country has said that it is null and void? That meant that there was no presidential election. So how does one win what didn't take place? Because anything that rests on nothing cannot stand, it must fall. Now, we should wait for the judgment of the Supreme Court, which should be issued very soon because the they indicated that it would be within 21 days.
Explanation for why.
Yes, how they arrived at the conclusion that they did, that majority of two-thirds, how they arrived at their conclusion. We should wait for that. I know some of that from the pleadings of Raila, and some of that is in the public space. But to start talking about all that now is over. Everybody, the Supreme Court audited the process, and there are claims that 5 million votes were unaccounted for. So how do you decide that Raila did not win, that Uhuru won in that sort of a situation? I don't even want to talk about the fact that there are internal problems now being discussed within the independent, so-called independent election and boundaries commission as to how a username and password was created for the chairman of the IEBC, which was used to alter figures 9,800 plus times. And then you are talking about, and we should be happy that the Supreme Court of Kenya did not behave like other courts in Africa that normally would have rushed everything under the ground and say, well, the incumbent continues, there is nothing. All those, we blame the sit-tight president. No, we should not blame sit-tight leaders. We should blame ourselves, whether as voters, people, the judiciary. There are times in this, on this continent, where the crowd had reacted, like in some of the cases in Europe. The first reaction was in Sudan. When the people got on the street, the general decided, no, I have to go.
You know, as a journalist, I'm more concerned about the ability and capacity of Raila to rule as president. He reminds me of someone like the Nigerian president, who is also a septuagenarian. Raila is 72 years, a very historic man. He's been with close to 9 political parties, spent the highest number of years in jail as a politician. Do you think that he still has the energy to rule as Kenya president?
Well, the only thing that could be easily done is to empirically deal with this issue. You see President Obasanjo, as a former president, is now officially 80, but definitely he never knew when he was exactly born. His contemporaries are in the range of 82 to 86. He is still dashing around like a young man, even faster than many.
Maybe he would have aged more quickly if he was still in power.
It's not an easy calculus that, okay, because this one is this. And in leadership, it is not how much of a running you are doing. It is how strategic you are. Because you are not supposed to be the one to go and check that they have installed the number of megawatts in a particular place. That's why you have ministers. If you are strategic in the appointment of your ministers, if you are strategic in the vision that you give to the country, then you are able to steer things like a pilot in the air. Raila is, from close quarters, still much stronger than what we are talking about. And for some reason, it appears that President Buhari, in his own case, is bouncing back fairly well compared to when he left.
There were fears for Kenya's foreign relations prior to the election of Uhuru Kenyatta, given the fact that both him and William Ruto, as at that time, were inductees at the International Criminal Court. How would you say that foreign relations has fared in the past 4 years under Kenyatta's administration?
Well, now I think that we can spend a whole day in trying to understand foreign relations. The problem of foreign relations is a very clear case of, you can be my enemy today and you are my friend tomorrow when my objective interests are involved. So it is for you to be asking yourself, what are the interests of the West? Is it democracy that they deceive us and talk about democracy, democracy every day? Or is it how much they can corner from the rest of the world in order to continue the development of their own societies, the inflow that is taking place more to China these days in terms of a newcomer on the scene? So, in terms of all the stories about The Hague, you know yourself what happened with respect to that. Bensouda, the prosecutor, had to give up. What do you call it? Many of the people who were to give evidence had died. And quite a number of them been declared missing, cannot be found. And some have said that they don't even remember whatever happened anymore. So it was not possible to continue with the case. But really, a different level of the issue is that court important to the West? Yes, some of them subscribe to it, but the United States did not subscribe to that court. So the appearance of wanting to, I don't share some of the excitement that people have on some of these Western control arrangements that we easily are in, and continue to see the relationships as one between equals and friends and whatever. That's not the case.
But it appears the world eventually welcomed and accepted Kenyatta. Obama eventually visited Kenya before he left office. Would you say that's the case now?
I think that right now, the relationship between the United States and Kenya is, I would say, good. It could be better because I'm not sure that Trump pays attention to whatever is happening at the level of diplomats talking to themselves, not the level of capital. American capital is nobody is hampering it. So, and that's what is prime for Trump. But you can see so many months after he became president, he is yet to appoint Assistant Secretary of State for Africa. So that tells you about relationship with the whole of Africa, not just Kenya, Nigeria, wherever you are talking about. In as much as nobody is disrupting capital, he couldn't be bothered. So I don't think that these issues of The Hague or whatever, or even the elections is once we can be sure that there is the stability without talking about justice, without talking about anything else. Once there is stability, let's rush everything away and move on.
Let's talk about the moral eligibility of the candidates in Kenya. Both Kenyatta and Odinga played prominent roles in the 2007 election, which deteriorated into a nationwide ethnic violence. There are different data, but some will say over 1,000 Kenyans lost their life. Over 250,000 were displaced. Odinga also conceded in your book that he played a central role in the 1982 Kenya coup. How come...
You are misquoting my book.
Okay, please correct me.
He did not concede that he played a role in the 1982 coup. I said that I am almost convinced that he did. And I indicated all... Yes, the facts as I saw them. But the 1982 coup took place in a different epoch in African history, in a different epoch when nobody would have reacted the way we are reacting today on anybody that is wanting to push out a dictator. So I don't want to go back into the question of dealing with...
But how come two individuals who were you know, relevant in an election where over 1,000 people died, are still very much relevant in the Kenya politics, and people are also ready to vote for them?
Well, the way you have put it, I'm not sure that that is, you know, we cannot just pack everybody together and make a judgment. Raila was not invited to the ICC. That meant that the international system set up in that investigated and found out that he wasn't involved in any of that. Yeah, and we all know who and who were actually invited. And then things happened and nothing could happen.
And that's the much we can bring to you this week in Global Arena. We'll be back next week, God willing, with the concluding part of that interview. The conversation, however, continues on all of our social media platforms. Until then, keep supporting a peaceful, integrated, and prosperous Africa. I am Nifemi Oguntoye. Thanks for being there.